So it's time to get wildly inappropriate.
Wait, hang on. Okay, I'm good.
Drama.
I like to get spanked.
Oh, are you trying to like,
Welcome to the Whiskey Tribe.
That's right.
We're gonna ask a whiskey judge, are whiskey competitions bullshit? This episode brought to you by the Wizard of Ads Partners. These are marketing professionals that specialize in turning small businesses into big businesses. You have various areas of expertise with strategists, the writers, the media buyers. You can go to wizardofads.com to check out the list of professionals. And like everything else in life, it comes down to finding the right fit. So check out wizardofads.com for free articles and advice and things that should probably be a tighter way to wrap up what I'm saying. Daniel, we are in dire need of a whiskey judge. Where does one find a whiskey judge?
You grow them with whiskey.
Of course.
Hang on. Let's just, all right.
That's pretty effective. What whiskey was that?
It's a good whiskey.
Heather Greene. Heather Greene, welcome to the Whiskey Tribe.
Heather, other than just being a world famous whiskey human being, has joined, originally was Ben Milam, is now Milam and Greene.
That's right. Very
distillery not far down the road from us in Blanco, Texas.
Woo-hoo, hill country.
And blending and creating and just doing all kinds of amazing shit down there.
So many questions about whiskey competitions.
Okay.
Simply put, what is this? What are they doing?
Okay, so every year there's a slew. There's the World Whiskey Awards, Wine and Spirits Competition.
Yeah.
San Francisco coming up. There's the American Craft Spirits Association. There's just a lot.
Right.
Yeah, there's a lot.
And those are the big ones.
Those are the big ones.
Beyond that, there's any number of...
All sorts of small ones.
Yeah, small events and festivals. Whiskey competitions that you have done, they've been the bigger ones, or are you all over the place? You do the small events?
I like small ones. I like small ones as well, local, regional, because these whiskey competitions offer me an opportunity to hone my palate, to see who's doing what, and quite frankly, to find faults in whiskey.
Are they usually part of like a live event, or do they have whiskeys where they're shipped into a judging panel?
Yes.
Okay,
shipped.
So both.
Somebody's coordinating the shipment of bottles, the bottles that are coming in, there's the place that they're being sent to, and then they organize all of the tastings blind, of course, you want a blind tasting. And then they ask the judges. So a lot of these competitions have really good qualified judges. I mean, these are ones, like, you don't just get into some of these. Some of them I had to apply to. I had to have recommendations from legends in the spirits industry.
Yeah.
Full application prior. What's your CV? What have you done? Where have you been? What makes you somebody that can actually judge a whiskey?
All right.
Okay, so you mentioned blind.
Yes.
Is that standard
across
the board? It has
Absolutely.
To be blind. Okay,
that's the best
for the
way to
for
do
the
it.
Big ones.
Oh, I'll have to be blind.
Okay.
I mean,
even the smaller ones.
You should be blind tasting every. In fact, I blind taste stuff in my house. Everybody's going to be swayed by packaging, by color, by the sight
that's
of kinda, something.
Kinda what I'm driving
by. We know that for sure. I mean, think about what marketing.
Yeah, it makes all
it's
the
like
difference
millions
in the world.
Of right,
yeah.
Millions of dollars on.
Well, because it works,
and it's beyond whether or not somebody makes the decision to buy. It actually goes into their literal enjoyment of that whiskey is affected by how much they paid for it, what were their expectations going
Who's
in.
Who's standing next to them while they're drinking it?
Like, right? What do they smell like?
Mm-hmm.
There's brain scans of being handed.
Wait, hang on. Okay, I'm good.
She did look at you.
Yeah, she did. What they smell like?
Actually, that's, you know what? No, I was kidding, but actually that's true because.
Actually, you do smell.
you smell.
I knew it.
Good judges know not to wear perfumes or heavy oils and colognes and stuff, but that will wreck your shit up.
Mm.
I mean, if someone's sitting next to me, you don't want to insult them, but you gotta be like,
oh. You're an get the out of here.
When I was writing my book, I went to one of the big think tanks on olfactory research, and they're based in Philadelphia. It's called the Monell Chemical Senses Institute. Okay, so chemical senses meaning not chemical the way some people think of chemical, but chemistry as in we're all made of parts of the periodic table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Everything in life.
And mostly gold.
Really? You think so?
Gold. Yeah.
Think
so? Can't be fool's gold.
But they have a great experiment there, and they had given me this little tiny, it looked like a ketchup, you know, like in a diner, like a ketchup container, and inside it were aromatics of vanilla and cinnamon. You puff it up and it's like powdery and you're like, oh, I smell vanilla and cinnamon. Now the next one is vanilla, cinnamon, and apple. Or vanilla, cinnamon, and chocolate. You smell that one and you say, what do you smell? And you're like, wow, this one smells like chocolate. But you're adapted already to the vanilla and the cinnamon.
That's the background there.
This is the trick with these judging competitions, is knowing the science behind it. You know, for me, it's like I'd like to switch them around. I like to kind of mess them up. And then collect the data over time to see if one of them is really starting to pop.
Which is the benefit that a lot of distillers get, because they're working with their own product in different environments over time, as opposed to... Now, okay, before we go any further, because we're going to talk about this, I want to start you guys, because I had to pick these whiskeys.
Sure.
I want Heather to analyze a whiskey, and Rex, who knows what the hell he's going to do.
I'm just going to drink free whiskey.
Yeah. Okay. This is a bourbon, and that's all I'm going to tell you.
So on the nose, I'm getting bourbon. Your move, Heather Greene. Your move.
I get Daniel on the nose.
He's everywhere.
This is from our top 10 most underrated bourbons by our tribe episode. So this is the number one whiskey that our tribe voted is actually amazing, but it's often underrated when people get snobby about bourbon.
This is very, I like it because it's delicate. It's not a heavy-handed bourbon, which is nice. It's refined. So the first things I think is like, there's almost like a little, I get like my first things like candy, like powdered sugar or something soft in there, which I think is really nice.
And then about how much time do you spend on the nose?
The majority of time on the nose.
Okay.
Yeah. So if I have like five or six in front of me or five in front of me, I'll go through the nosing. I'll go through the nosing again. Oh, I'll go through the nosing. I'll take notes. I'll go back through the nosing. I'll switch around. And then I start to get like a little bit of an architecture, like, okay, these two are standing out to me. You can sort of, and then right away, you can also maybe, if there's faults in the whiskey, like if there's like a cheesiness, a mustiness, and then you start kind of narrowing it down right there based on the nose.
I'm not naming specific notes because I don't want to.
Do it. A lot of apple and lighter fruits and florals. You know, there's a pretty note to this to me.
Do the judges have the same criteria even that they're applying to the whiskeys?
There's protocols, right? So the glasses will be standard. They'll have, you know, these will be covered so that they don't kind of mingle, all the aromatics mingle together. You'll have that. You'll have like, you know, recommendations not to add water. However, there's something else, is there's cultural variability. So we have to keep that, I keep that in mind. So cultural variability means that I don't smell like him. But that's good, right?
Thank you for that.
I think we're all grateful.
There are 450 genes that determine how we taste and smell.
Right.
And those can vary, almost a third of those can vary amongst us. And that's tremendous, and it's really something to think about.
Yeah,
because
you
have some people that are going to be very, very sensitive to, say, vanilla.
Yeah.
Well, most humans are sensitive to vanilla, but some will nose it in like a particular parts per million, where somebody else needs a little bit less, somebody else needs a little bit more.
Right.
On terms of taste, our bitter receptors are all varying amongst us as well. So some people, as you know, like are really sensitive to like dark chocolate, or they want sugar and cream in their coffee.
Well, that's a really interesting point.
All of that stuff.
Because
is
if people are you know, sensitive to varying degrees to various flavors, you also have, and we talk about all the time how subjective taste can be.
Oh, total age, gender, what you have for breakfast, how stressed out they are, all of these things are gonna affect.
How many judges before you think you get a real breadth of coverage?
That's interesting. I would say it's more about a diversity of ages and people as well as the number. And it would be interesting to see as we move towards more diversity in that, how whiskeys are gonna change.
All right, you wanna know what it is?
I do.
All right,
can I
get that bottle? Yes.
Wild Turkey.
Yes, it's Wild Turkey 101.
I love Wild Turkey. You know, it's interesting, I don't remember some of those apple-y floral notes. Good on you,
I
like Wild Turkey.
All right, we're gonna get to a rye after this.
All right.
Okay, we make a rye, and I'm so tired of people saying, rye, I don't like rye. It's like pepper, it's green, it's this, because marketing for a long time was trying to differentiate what makes rye different. And sometimes it's like that. But this does not have that at all.
No, it does not. None of the licorice or that.
It almost comes across like a bourbon. In fact, I would have a really, I personally don't feel
I'm not
like
finding the bourbon cherry or that honey, but I am getting that little bit of a floral character we got from the previous, the 101.
That's right. I do too. Yeah. And it's interesting because it's not reading as a rye. I wouldn't have guessed like, oh, I'm drinking a rye whiskey.
Yeah. So which rye did we have here?
So this one, ironically, another turkey. This is from our list of
company.
What is the right whiskey for you?
Okay.
And they voted in a rye to talk about
Yeah.
What's
the right whiskey for you?
Yeah. Well, similarly to the Wild Turkey, you know, I was saying this is soft and it's like
45%.
Yeah, that's interesting. So they're getting some of the same kind of qualities in the rye that you get out of the Wild Turkey 101.
Yeah.
If you asked me blindly, yes. I was like, oh, that makes sense because this is that soft. It had that, didn't have enough of that peppery, that right. spice, as I said.
Yeah, yeah.
It's soft, it's nice.
All right, we're going to move real quick. Well, you ask whatever follow up questions because I got a little bit of a thing I want to try out at
the
end.
Fine.
Oh.
No. But then there's this.
There's what?
Well, something I like to call you'll see. So this is a smoky Ooh. Scotch.
Already, to me, it's not. It's not as balanced as I like a smoky scotch.
Ah, interesting. Yeah. I know, I totally understand that for sure.
So
this is going
like,
for drama. This is a scotch that's going for drama.
I like to get spanked. I'm just putting it out there. I'm loving this. This is so nice.
I love spankings, smoked and peated scotches, but for me, I also want something else in
some
there.
Body.
I want some that have, like, I can get a little, like, vanillas in there or heather or. Earth, some more phenols.
Pull that bottle out because she's not going to be surprised when she sees what it is.
But, oh, of course.
Yeah. I said that.
Of course I loved it. It's the optimal.
I know, I did that. I totally did that on purpose.
I mean, you know.
Don't drink it then because I don't want you to destroy the palate.
I mean, I like what they're doing, but, you know, I appreciate it. But, like, for this, for me, it's just unidimensional. So I like to look at more complexity on the nose than that.
Okay, I want you to try something before we're done over here.
Okay.
You ready?
I'm ready.
I just want to know what you think about this thing.
Oh gosh.
I'll let you know it's ours.
Okay, that's good to know.
Yeah.
I don't like being
I'm going to let you know it's ours.
Okay.
I know.
But here's the thing.
But you don't know what it is.
But we're talking about subjectivity and whiskey tasting. When you taste a whiskey at the home of the whiskey, it always tastes better.
Right, so if you take this home, pure garbage.
Yeah, that's right.
This is single malt. I want to basically get your nosing notes and taste notes because it's 7 months old.
Oh, I was gonna say, I would give this time.
Yeah.
I'd be like, so, I mean, it helps me to know it's 7 months old because if you were just to give this to me, I would say, you know, I would need more time.
Yeah.
It needs more time in a barrel to richen and deepen.
Yep. So let me ask
We've been pulling samples once a month.
Yeah.
However, great, because a lot of people aren't doing that, the distillers enough. But I will say, for 7 months old, like, I don't notice any fault, so I don't get any, like, there's no cheesiness in there, there's not a mustiness
green
in there,
pine.
There's not that green pine, and I get a nice, well, there's also a chocolate note in there that I really like.
Mm-hmm.
Why is there a chocolate note?
We peated this. This is 50% peated malt to 50% unpeated malt, but it presents as, like, an ashy finish.
Well, it's the retronasal faction. But
yeah, it's coming together very,
really
very well, but, you know, whenever you make something, obviously you're very biased. It's hard. Every time we go back to this, we check on it, I was like, this is going in a very exciting direction.
It is.
Yes.
Beautiful flavors.
Old.
7 months. Can you believe that? Welcome to Texas.
I have one final question about judging.
Okay.
How are they compensated for doing that work?
Cars or boats?
Or basically just paid in whiskey stock?
Stock.
Some,
yeah, stock.
They pay usually your hotel room at a small fee. You don't do it to make money.
Okay.
I mean, I do them because I really like to be on the pulse of what people are doing. It's an opportunity to taste so many different whiskeys. It's an opportunity to keep my nosing abilities and tasting abilities up. But you're not doing it for cash.
Yeah.
You know, you're
not doing
it for the yacht.
Well, I'm
for
doing
passion.
It for the yacht.
Yeah.
Important announcement.
So on Saturday, March 7th,
yes,
Rex and I are going to be at the Texas Whiskey Festival,
here
which
in
is
Austin.
Out at the ranch,
West Austin,
out by Hamilton, on Hamilton Pool Road, 7:30 to 9:30.
Tons and tons of Texas distilleries pouring their whiskey.
That's right.
Now, the Whiskey Tribe, they're going to have an old-timey church
to be
the official location for a Whiskey Tribe meetup of the Magnificent Bastards.
Old-school pews and everything.
Yeah.
And I got a banner that's going to hang out front so you know where it is.
So in the description below, we're going to put a link to the Texas Whiskey Festival. What day did you say was happening?
It's March 7th, Saturday, March 7th.
All right, that's coming up. Join us if you can. A lot of MBs are going to be meeting up. We're getting to the final tail end of this thing. So it's time to get wildly inappropriate.
Okay. I'm ready.
When you're not drinking whiskey, what are you gravitating towards?
Gin.
Oh,
gin.
Yeah. We did a whole episode talking
gin.
About
it. I love, love gin. And I'm crazy about gin. I went to Junipalooza in London. I drank it.
Junipalooza.
Yeah.
Was the cover band called Jenny Hendrix?
I'd like to publicly apologize. What is currently your favorite whiskey?
Oh, are you trying to, like, My personal favorite are the ones I'm working on.
Oh, there you go. Okay. Yeah, of course. Okay. Yeah.
Personal favorite.
Mild and Green.
Yeah, it has to be Mild and Green. I poured 20 plus years experience right into one brand and, you know, with my team.
Wrong answer.
Love it.
Oh. It's a sourced MGP called
Heather. Heather, same question.
Uh-huh.
What is your favorite whiskey?
Oh, yes! Yeah. Taking the whole wallet.
Eleanor.
And the wallet. Eleanor!
In the Texas Monthly article that recently came out.
Yeah.
How annoyed were you that Crowded Barrel got more ink than My Lemon Green?
Oh, I have a dartboard right now.
Yes! Wait, I'm gonna show you where the picture of Rex is.
I think somebody used to wipe themselves in the back.
Yeah. Oh, we bop and dippity hop, and as happy as I can be.